Good afternoon and welcome on the Sunset Safari. Whew, your timing could not have been more perfect. Jandre and myself were begging that kudu to stay where... Oh, there's another one there. Never mind. So my tremendous relief might have been slight overkill, it appears, since there is another kudu off to the right. I was desperately hoping that one of them might stay in shot for you. Welcome on your live safari experience, coming to you live from Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserves in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa, where our nibbling kudu is enjoying her late lunch. My name is Jamie and this afternoon I have Jandre on camera with me. James is out and about with Brian going looking for lions, and as I said, we're the only place in the world you can come to for a live and interactive safari experience. So if you have any questions, you can send those through on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And please do let us know. Oh, there's a baby. I don't know if it's going to stay in view, but there is a tiny baby little kudu walking at the back. It has gone. The baby kudu has gone. That keeps being my day today. I spot the baby animal and then it disappears from view immediately. How far back do you think we can roll, Jandre? It is a glorious morning. No, it's not a glorious morning. It's a glorious afternoon. No, this little baby's going to keep us guessing. We'd have to go around. It is a glorious afternoon out here in the African bush. 23 degrees centigrade, which is 74 in Fahrenheit. And it is actually quite hot in the sunshine. And of course the temperatures, it is midwinter here in South Africa, so the temperature does drop right down as soon as the sun sets, but for now it is the kind of afternoon that makes you want to go and bask in the sunlight somewhere. Desperately trying to get you a view of this little baby kudu. Negative, that's not going to work either. We can do this. Everybody, we're gonna search for a gap. There we go. I will show you this little baby kudu, because it's very cute. Hiding away behind mom. There's a couple of little ones disappearing into the trees. Rightio, while our kudu are lovely and very graceful, however, they are not quite as flat as the animals that James has just found for you. Let us head across to the most iconic animal of the African bush.
Good afternoon, everybody. Sorry about that. I was just put to sleep by these cats, which you can see are doing what cats do very best, and that is, of course, absolutely nothing. Welcome on our live safari. I do apologize if I offended any of you with that start. I thought I was being rather amusing, didn't you, Brian?
I enjoyed it.
Thank you so much, Brian. Brian is on camera today. And he has a special guest on the thumb today. Who's that, Brian?
Pinchy Whiner.
And it's Pinchy Whiner, the crab, the freshwater crab, no longer resident. Well, we don't know where he's resident. He could still be in his old hole. He might have moved. Very nice, Brian. Excellent. We've come to these lions. We knew they were going to be asleep, of course, because lions sleep during the middle of the day, and they will move around probably as it gets a bit cooler during the night. 23 degrees Celsius, which is roughly 74 degrees Fahrenheit, if I'm not mistaken. So quite a warm day for the middle of winter, and these lions are luxuriating in the shade of the winter woodland. As you can see, he did look up briefly as we came in here, but then went straight back to sleep. And so we'll have a look at him quickly, and then we'll have a look at the females just down the way. Only three of them, and I'm interested as to where the other two are. The one certainly was with her little babies this morning, and we're going to head off that way and see if we can have a look at them this afternoon. The other one, I suspect, also with those other three little cubs, but where they are, we don't know. quite near the camp. We had some bushbuck alarm calling earlier, and we thought we might find the little cubs and their mother somewhere around there. We did have a brief look around before we came up here, but they were not around. So that's the case here. We are as live as Jamie is, believe it or not, even though I started off the show fast asleep. Do talk to us, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. It would be lovely to hear from you, and especially if things get a little quiet on the animal front. It's always nice to spark some conversations about Africa, conservation, many issues that you might want to talk about regarding conservation and the African wilderness. Well, we'd be happy to try and address those as we go along. Also, I know there has been quite a lot of query about going to visit those little cubs, which are now, there we go, huge action. You see that, Brian? I think a stick snapped nearby, which got a fright. I'm going to roll forward. There have been quite a lot of queries about us going to see those little cubs, which are now probably only about, 14 days old or so. And a lot of you wondering whether that's sensitive or not, or whether we should be viewing cubs that age or not. And I'll go through that as we drive there, because it's important you understand that we're being as sensitive as we possibly can. I think the clutch in this car is about to go, which is slightly disconcerting when you're surrounded by lions, even if they are asleep. Just going to ease our way in here. Oh, I'm sorry to disturb you, madam. I've no doubt you'll fall asleep almost immediately. Sorry. That's a stick flicking up on the bottom of the car that's woken them up, and that makes me feel very bad. I do apologize, lions. Even though I know they will go back to sleep immediately, it's never nice when you cause them to react in a way that they wouldn't otherwise. Look at all the flies flying around them there. fast asleep again. Chucky baby. Interesting Twitter handle, that Chucky baby. You want to know when the last time we saw the Birmingham boys was? Well, Brian, the last time we saw the Birmingham boys was 2 minutes ago, would you say? About 2 minutes ago, Chucky baby. That lion we just saw is one of the Birmingham boys. And there he is. He's just a recumbent and asleep. And Chucky baby, I'm going to call you CCB. I can't bring myself to keep saying Chucky baby. CCB, they are... I think the reason there's a slight confusion is that they are not always together, of course. In fact, they're very seldom together. And the more dominant they get in the area, the less the time that they will spend with each other. Normally, a coalition of four like this will split into threes, at least into twos. But these guys seem to spend a great deal of time on their own, either with females or just patrolling literally on their own. And sometimes a group of two, seldom a group of three, and almost never anymore a group of four of them. So CCB, there is the Birmingham boy, I think different from the one we saw yesterday on Cheetah Plains, who I think was Birmingham number two. And I remember that because he has those two very obvious little nicks above his right nostril. There we go, beautiful belly of lioness, and you can see there if she is lactating. She is definitely lactating, that lioness. So which mother she is, we're not sure. We know that there are at least three lionesses within this pride that are lactating. That's one of them. You can see the very clear swelling of her teats. You can also maybe make out the discoloration of the fur around them, which is brought on by the extensive suckling of her cubs. You can't see her face, and I don't want to get any closer, of course, because you saw how those two reacted, because it's just a bit thick in here. They weren't nervous at all. It was just the banging of the sticks on the bottom of the car that made them a little bit skittish. Anyway, they are completely at peace here, and that is the way of lions. Sandra, Very nice question from you, of course, especially being dark-haired myself. Well, I used to be when I had hair. And, Sandra, you say, is it true that female lions prefer darker-haired males? The answer is yes, to an extent. But it's not clear whether it's them actually doing the selecting or the fact that the darker mane represents a greater testosterone level and therefore a greater dominance in a coalition of males that sort of provides a selective pressure. So, for example, the coalition of males that got tossed out of here by the Birmingham boys when they came a marauding exactly a year ago, one of them had a ginger mane and he was called Ginger, and the other one had a black mane and he wasn't called Black Mane, he was called Hairy Belly. And they both are still called that, and they live down at Londolozi on the Sand River at the moment. And he certainly, the one with the dark mane, certainly seemed to do the bulk of the mating. Now, whether that was because they selected for him or because he was just dominant over his brother, I'm not sure. So that black mane absolutely indicates a greater level of testosterone in the body, and it turns the mane much blacker. And that can have two effects. Either she's picking up, the lionesses are picking up on it, or he is more dominant over his brother, and so his brother backs off when there's any kind of competition. So one of the two. But yes, essentially it is true that a more black-maned lion will probably have greater mating opportunities. Jamie has got some very unusual winter animals to show you, so let's go across to her. I'm going to move to the cubs.
Very unusual winter animals indeed, and they're not animals. They're leaves fluttering in the air, rising air currents, the thermals that the vultures ride on. But I don't know how easily you can see this. Genre is doing an amazing job of capturing it. But it looks like floating gold specks. It's absolutely stunning. At first I thought I was imagining it. But it's the leaves blowing in the wind and catching the light. It is incredible to watch. It really looks like somebody's thrown a handful of giant gold glitter into the sky. I've never seen anything like it. This is definitely one of the prettiest times of year to be out in the bush. These contrasting colours. Incredible. So, so beautiful. It's tumbling out of the air. I suppose for those of you who experience the incredible colour change of your autumn or fall, with leaves changing the colours, and maybe perhaps this isn't such an extraordinary experience for you, but for us it is just really beautiful, especially against the expansive African sky, which is the bluest of the blue on afternoons like today. And then of course, just for fun, because we can, this view of the moon and all its craters as it slowly, slowly approaches the point of being full. So that's nice every now and again in our frenetic search for the various animals and, well, animal life of Juma and Arethusa and the Sabi Sand. Nice every now and again to stop and just look at the view. We're going to head across to Cheetah Plains, actually, is my plan. Speaking of views, we're going to check along the southern boundary just to see if Queen Karula hasn't made her way back across. This morning was quite dramatic with her, we think, being chased off the kill that she had south of our boundary and then followed back to her cubs by two hyenas. Oh, alarm calling, go away birds. Go away. Let's go investigate what's got them upset. There is a good chance she's come back north. And there we go. Of course, Aaron, I think, watching in New Zealand. And Aaron, thinking along the same lines I am thinking of, which is, I think, I don't know, I'm not 100% sure, but I'm relatively certain that I found brown hyena tracks on Cheetah Plains. And I thought it might be a good idea to go back to that area around evening time, especially in winter when the temperature drops sooner and the nocturnal animals come out faster. I thought it might be a nice idea to go and investigate the whether or not we can find, because that would be incredibly exciting. If we had a regular brown hyena walkway or pathway, that would be fantastic. Trying to find where this red-crested korhan is, and now the go-away birds are calling as well, again. That high-pitched whistling. Oops, my lip is too dry. See if he responds to me or if he's not... Quite the high-pitched whistle, that. Sorry, everybody, if you're feeling slightly deafened at home. I'm trying to call the red-crested korhan. He's not far, he's close. But they've got a slight ventriloquist nature to their call. Hoping he might even give us his flight display, or it is the wrong time of year. Oh, I think I won that. I don't see him anywhere. He's probably strutting out looking for this rival red-crested korhan. He's really not far away. I don't know if any of you have managed to spot him. I haven't. I don't think Jandre has. Perhaps he's hiding in the trees somewhere there. Okay, I'm not going to call him anymore. He might be intimidating and intimidated into thinking that there is an enormous male red-crested korhan about to compete for his territory, and I don't want to do that. Pity, you somewhere here? I would show you what he looks like, but unfortunately my bird book is where we usually live at Inga's house, but we've been temporarily displaced from there for now, and I unfortunately left my bird book there, which is very silly. I'm sure he's sitting on a termite mound or something. Okay. Guess not. No response from him. Okay. See if there's any tracks of Karula coming back across. And a very big hello to Tucker, who is 4 years old. Hello, Tucker. I hope you're enjoying your safari experience. Now, Tucker would like to know, do the bugs tickle animals' fur? And yes, they do. They definitely do, Tucker. So the flies especially, you'll see, even with a sleeping lion, you'll get the ears flicking and the tail flicking because it's irritating them, it's tickling them, tickling the sensitive fur. Now, Tucker, I don't know if you've got a dog or a cat at home, but you might see them doing that with flies as well, twitching their ears, twitching their tail to make the insects go away. And it's not just flies, it's also things like ticks that crawl on the animal's fur, make them feel really, really itchy. And so often what they'll do, Tucker, because they don't have five fingers and fingernails to scratch themselves, so what they'll often do is either scratch with their hooves or their paws, or if there's something big like an elephant, then they'll go running up to a tree. Imagine I'm an elephant, Tucker. Just imagine. Okay, I know I'm a bit smaller than an elephant, but I've got a fly on my face, and it's attached to my cheek. Go away. Go away! Now imagine I'm an elephant, Tucker. So this is what an elephant's going to do if it's got an itch somewhere. It's going to walk up to a tree just like this one, like I'm going to do now. Okay. So Tucker, you have to use your imagination here, because I know I don't really look like an elephant. But imagine I'm an elephant with a big trunk. And if I'm feeling a little bit itchy, what elephants do to get rid of the ticks and the insects that irritate them is they'll go up to a tree like this, and they'll actually have a proper scratch like this. Give themselves a good scratch all over on the marula tree bark. And this is the perfect kind of bark for it, because it's not too rough, so it doesn't hurt their skin, but it's rough enough that it works like a back scratcher. So Okay, well, I don't think an elephant would be able to do this. But you get the idea, Tucker. Now, that's what you'd have to do if you're an elephant and there's an insect bugging you, irritating your skin. I had a sudden thought as I went wandering in there that that's, I think, exactly where Karula went in that block. Also, that was little Gowrie. But it was only 5 meters. Okay. Right, now that we've shown Tucker how elephants scratch their skin, and I've taken the skin off the top 3 vertebrae of my lumbar region, we can carry on. I'm having a bad earpiece day. I'm sorry for fiddling. My earpiece, for some reason today, doesn't want to be attached to my ear. Alright, well, we look for Karula and slowly move our way to the east. Let's go over to James and find out what he's up to.
You joined us just in time, everyone. What we're doing here is we're now going to go off-road in here. And before we do, I'm just going to quickly address this query that everyone's been asking, or many of you have been asking about the sensitivities around these little cubs. So, you know, there's no hard and fast rule. There is a rule that we don't view them as a game drive sighting if the mother is not there. There is, however, a rule in place here where you're allowed to go and have a look if mum's there. You can stay and have a look, and then maybe one or two other game drive vehicles during the course of a drive will come in. The sensitivity around it is to do with smell and to do with sound. And so we don't want vehicles going in and out the whole time, because any threat that there might be, mainly from hyenas, possibly leopards, maybe wild dogs, but it's largely hyenas, any threat that there might be from hyenas would obviously be that much higher if the sound of vehicles is moving all the time. Likewise, if there's a huge smell of these vehicles, perhaps a hyena coming up wouldn't be smelt as easily. I'm not so convinced about that one, but I'm happy to go with it. So by going in briefly, stopping the car, not making a noise, not moving and repositioning the whole time, we are not being insensitive. By pulling in and out repeatedly and moving the car to get a better view, then yes, that probably would be insensitive. So that's what we're going to go and do. If mum is not there, we'll have a quick look and then we'll move out again. If mum is there, then we'll stop and we'll have a nice sighting, hopefully, of those little ones. They might all be gone by now. She may have moved the den. Okay, and the fact that she has kept the den where it is for so long now indicates that she personally, the mother, is not disturbed by the presence of vehicles, because that is what makes lionesses move their dens. Lionesses move their dens quickly. If they are disturbed, they will move them from time to time, every sort of a few days or so. But if she'd been disturbed by our presence the first time round, she'd have moved them straight away. So please don't worry about that. And if you have any questions around the sensitivities here, please feel free to ask them. I will address them with pleasure. And it's wonderful to know that we do have so many concerned people around the world. You're concerned for these lions specifically, but it also means that you're concerned about conservation and African wildlife in general. And that's wonderful. So I'm happy to talk about that. I'm happy to debate it, even if you'd like to. Within reason. She found a wonderful little den site here, because it's right in a drainage line. It's quite steep, which means that things like buffalo, which would kill lion cubs, can't really get in there. And so it's a really clever spot for her to be. And the best place to film them from, of course, would be to get out of the car, climb across the knobthorn tree that is leaning over the drainage line, and film them from there. That, of course, would result very quickly in death, because the mother would be very upset with you. So we won't do that, will we, Brian?
Not today,
no. Hello, Mercedes. I've got a nice way for you to remember this particular thing. For lions, it's 666. Now, that's not meant to be any kind of the number of the devil, but 6 days before their eyes open, 6 weeks before they start moving with the pride, and 6 months before they wean. As far as I remember, that's how it goes. I mean, obviously there are variations there. So you want to know when they'll start moving their cubs on the hunt, or when they'll accompany the pride on the hunt. They'll start accompanying the pride probably from about 8 months. But they won't contribute to the hunt until they're at least a year old. They just hang back and watch. Right, let's see what we can find in here. I'm going to go very slowly. They're just down in here, or they were, and I can see Mum is there. Or can I? Yes, Mum is there. So that's good news. And the little ones are there too, and Mum is watching us. Can you see there, Brian? You just let me know when you have a view of the little ones. Now, Mum is not particularly pleased, I can see. I think she will relax. She's just watching us quite carefully, so I'm going to speak very quietly. There, she's relaxing. You can see her eyes blinking. She's starting to go to sleep. You can't see her. I can see her. You can see the little one, though, trying to suckle. Now, if Mum was not comfortable with us, what she'd do is start growling. And she's not growling at all. She's young, you know. I think this must be her first litter. Beautiful. Can you see her right there, Brian?
2 degrees.
It's not the best. We're just going to stay here and let... Can you hear the fish eagle calling above us? There we go, Mum is just relaxing now. She wasn't as relaxed as I've seen her before. So I'm just going to let her settle before I think about maybe moving forward. There, she's yawning. I know you can't see it, everyone, but I can see it. There we go. She's relaxing now. There you can see her eyes. Starting to close quietly. So let's sit here for a little while and see what happens. I don't think those little things are going to move too much. They look like they're trying to have a bit of a suckle underneath there. Now just 14 days old, or plus minus 14 days old. Just see if I can't get a slightly better view. And I might roll forward just now. There we go. Brian, is that at all good for you?
It's all right.
This is fantastic. I can see all three of them. Brian, I don't think with your extra height there, I'm not sure that I'm going to get a better view. I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll just roll forward slightly. How's that, Brian? Is that fine? It's not going to. It's going to be good right now. How's that? Okay. Right, everybody, I'm going to just call this in on the radio. This is just too wonderful. Look at the tiny little things there. Just trying to suckle. And Mum hasn't sat up at all. Stations, I have come to this position. The mother is on location. There is a 1 out of 5 visual. I think we should limit it to 3 vehicles per drive, 1 vehicle at a time. This is just my opinion. And there's almost no movement if you can when you get in here, because the visual isn't great, and you have to be quite close to see what's going on. Isn't that lovely? Mark, I don't know what you mean by a unique spot. Mark, you've got to be pretty close to get a view. So just very sensitive, slow movements around here. Aaron, thank you very much. You say you say that you love these cubs because they take the manliness out of me. Well, I'm not sure why that's why I love them, but I do get your point. I was thoroughly chastised today by Geraldine for talking in baby voice on drive, so you'll notice I haven't done it. Well, I nearly started doing it, but I didn't do it earlier. Geraldine, I hope you've taken note. So yes, they do completely, absolutely make me talk in a very unmanly way. They're all suckling now. Isn't that lovely? That is just too stunning. So three little ones, no way to sex them at this stage. And they're all just suckling. I hope you can make out the detail there. But all three of them are suckling now. Michael, interesting, very interesting comment from you. You say, with domestic cats, if you start blinking with them and they start blinking in time with you, then it indicates that they have some sort of trust and they trust you. Would the same work with lions or leopards? I would be very reticent to say yes in that particular situation. I don't know. I have stared at lions. I've stared at them in the eye, both on foot and in vehicles, and I've seen nothing but, blankness, basically. And that's not to insult them at all, but I don't think that the level of communication that exists with the domestic cat and one of these exists. So I would say no. I'm going to go with no. I don't think that the same would apply, that if that lioness started blinking in time with you, that she was indicating some form of trust. I might be wrong, but I don't think so. Isn't that lovely? Now, just to give you an idea of how big they are, they're about the size of a ruler. They're about 12 inches long, each of them, from top to the end of their tails, so they are very small indeed. And they'll grow amazingly quickly. So the other ones that many of you have seen, that we saw also of the Nkuhuma pride, they are, how old are they now? They're just over 6 weeks. They've started moving with the pride. Yeah, well, they're not all the time, but they certainly move from place to place with the pride, and they went to that kill on Arethusa, which is a long way from here. I mean, that was a good walk for them. And they are substantially bigger than this. Almost double the size, I'd say. Catherine, I have to agree with you. You say you can't believe we're so privileged to watch these little things. I can't believe it either. I've never had this privilege before. In all my years of guiding, I've seen young lion cubs, but I've never been in a position where we've been able to view them in a den site like this. It's just, It's too special. This is why, of course, I speak in slightly babyish tones sometimes. Brian, I've held it together today, though, haven't I?
To a degree.
Yes. Much more manly today.
Mm, voice is deeper.
Roof, roof. Not sure roof, roof qualifies as manly. I'm just going to try and move that stick out of the way, everybody. How's that? Cindy in Tennessee, you want to know about the Styx Pride and if there was any update on them. They were seen yesterday, indeed, on Chitwa Chitwa. And there on Chitwa Chitwa, I don't know if the cubs were there, but certainly they had a female, or three females, with the Birmingham boys. So I don't really know. Oh, look at that. This is incredible, people. This really is something special. So the Styx Pride cubs I don't know about. I certainly haven't heard anything negative about them. But you see, they spend quite a lot of time on Chitwa Chitwa, southern end of Cheetah Plains, and onto Mala Mala. And that's why we don't see them very often. Jamie's going across to Cheetah Plains now. I don't know how well they searched Cheetah Plains this morning. I don't mean that negatively. I don't know how many people were around on Cheetah Plains this morning. Maybe they're around there. Look at the little ears moving with each suck. So, if we go back to the sensitivity of it, you can see, well, I hope you can see, that we're not having an effect here. Mum looked up as we came in. She's gone back to sleep. The cubs are suckling normally. We're making no noise. Were a hyena to come across here, she'd pick it up immediately. Were there to be some form of rustling in the bushes, she'd pick that up and hear it immediately. This is why I'm talking quite quietly. And is our smell affecting them? I don't believe so. I'm not sure how much they rely on smell when they are in a position like this. Probably a little bit. So that could be the only thing I suspect that we could say was maybe compromising the sensitivity of the situation. We're not going to be here for long, probably only another 3 or 4 minutes, and then we'll move out. Oh, look. Oh dear, I did it. Bad luck. Second time, sorry about that. It's difficult to be manly around them, you know, Brian.
I do.
And Brian and I, of course, you know, we're doubly unmanly because as soon as it gets vaguely cold, we put jerseys on, which is very unmanly, isn't it, Brian? It's the least manly thing you can do. Susan, a nice question from you about whether or not the lionesses ever go into, come into the den site before the mother's ready to introduce them to the pride. Yes, sometimes, and certainly we only found this den site because there were other lions around here. Jamie was following the lions trying to kill a buffalo very close to here a few nights ago. And that is the only reason that we know they're here. So absolutely it does happen. But that's not necessarily a bad thing. She doesn't really mind. She would happily introduce them to the pride if the pride was here. The only reason she doesn't kind of introduce them or make them move with the pride earlier is because it's difficult for them to move with the pride. They're not big enough yet to be able to walk on their own properly. So lovely. Trying to take a picture, but it's hopeless through all that bush. So special. Like I say, in all my years of being out here, I'd never spent time like this at a lion's den site. I've never had this incredible privilege, those little feet, everyone, about the size of a silver dollar. You can, well, any dollar, I guess. Isn't a dollar about that big? So they really are so very tiny. Slightly, probably slightly bigger than a domestic cat's foot, but not much. But they're definitely fatter. And you can see they're more exploded. So you can see that the three or the four pads at the front are further away from the back pad than they would be on a domestic cat. And look at the muscle definition there. You see this strength there in the forefoot. Now, Michael, you ask a very good question here. You say, if these cubs make it, is there any chance that they could grow up and mate with their father or their uncles, so one of the Birmingham boys, or likewise, is there any chance that they could... she's up. She's heard something. I think it's babblers that are just foraging around here. Michael, I will get back to your question because it's a very good one. And the answer is yes, it is possible. But this is why, or one of the interesting things about a coalition 10 years, you say, or you suggest, would another coalition take over? A coalition's tenure is normally not much longer than 2.5 to 3 years, which basically means that by the time these lionesses... let's assume that 1.5 of those three are lionesses. By the time they're at breeding age, the coalition will either be in its last throes and be about to toss out, or that what will happen is that they will mate with their daughters, and in so doing, they do create incest. But within the next year, normally another coalition will take over, and so those. Got something in her nose. So that coalition does come in. Sorry, I'm just hearing some noise behind us. So the new coalition would kill those cubs born of incest. And that's normally what would happen, Michael. But remember with the cats that incest for up to 6 generations is seemingly okay. Doesn't seem to have any deleterious effects. So incest is quite possible with these cubs. Likewise, it's possible that a young male might try and mate with his mother or his sisters, but that's why they get tossed out when they're about 3.5 or 3 years old, in the same way the junior was as he started to try and mate with these lionesses of the Nkuhuma pride. Now, junior, for those of you who don't know, was a male who grew up with the pride. I think probably the same age as this female we're looking at here, about 4 years old now, and she might actually be younger than that. You can see her nose still completely pink, so I'm pretty sure these are her first cubs. Okay, everyone, we're going to pull out of here. I'm not going to sit here all afternoon. We did have a wonderful sighting. I only used baby talk twice, and I think I'm to be congratulated for that, don't you, Brian?
Congratulations, James.
Thank you very much, Brian. Okay, here we go. And the clutch on this car is a little bit dodgy. Let me just see what she's doing. Okay. Just want to see what she does quickly. Let's just sit here for 2 more minutes. We'll pull out once Jamie's on cheetah planes. There we go. Just wanted to see if they didn't start having a little bit of a play. Yeah, I I can't see anything going on here. All right, everyone, let's go across to Jamie. She's got something much larger and exciting to show you. Well, not more exciting than this, but certainly much larger. And we'll catch you once we're out.
Oh, I think our elephants are definitely exciting. I would describe them as exciting, but they're definitely a lot larger and certainly a lot less fluffy than the lion cubs that you've been looking at with James. And we've found ourselves at an elephant roadblock, which is actually relatively inconvenient because this is the well-known signal black hole of Cheetah Plains. Just as you drive through into the entrance, our signal always disappears here. So I'm hoping that by staying remarkably still, we will be able to show you these elephants, because obviously at this point, I cannot go racing past. I wonder if this is the same. I don't think it is. But I was wondering if perhaps it was not the same herd that we saw. Yes, oh no, not yesterday morning, this morning. On the sunrise safari, they had the tiniest little baby. Too cute for words. And I have to tell you that secretly I've been hoping to relocate that herd on Cheetah Plains once again. Just because I would love for you to see that little elephant calf. It's only a couple of weeks old. There's a little one. There you go, the best, definitely the best view you've had of a little baby elephant. Okay, dare we brave the repositioning? That is the question. Jandre thinks no, I think yes. What shall we do? Oh, look, little baby's actually going for the... I don't know if you can see it from your angle, Jandre. Giving nonsense to one of the other vehicles. Hey, little one. There is another vehicle there. There's a Chitwa vehicle. And the little baby's doing what they often do to us, which is racing forward and charging them and then getting a little bit scared. And now indecisive and not quite so brave as he was initially. It's okay, little one. There's no shame in admitting defeat. Perhaps to be spurred on by the company of the other elephant calf now. Or perhaps distracted. Distracted, it seems. Oh, are we going to go for the vehicle? Let's go forward a bit. There we go. Right, let us brave the repositioning. Try and get you another view of this elephant herd. Unfortunately, they are moving in the wrong direction. They're going towards Nkoro. Not the wrong direction for them, obviously. Hello, guys. Ooh, lovely big herd. Ooh, everybody keep fingers crossed for signal. I think I'm gonna... Oops. Okay, we're going to stop. We're going to stop here. Nobody breathe, nobody move. We seem to have seen. That's mighty unfriendly. I was waving, nobody waved back. Oh no, now this is just embarrassing. Nobody wants to wave at me at all. Oh well. Watch the elephants instead. Lots and lots of elephants busy munching on sickle bush, largely. And while we are with our elephants here on Cheetah Plains, Benji, I keep doing that. Every time we mention Benjamin, I get his name confused with the person asking the question. New Zealand Aaron. Has said that another baby that it would be delightful to see would be Benjamin Button, the elephant that is old before his time, baby elephant with the most wrinkly forehead in the entire world. You are absolutely right, I would love to see Benji again. Oh, yay, I got a wave. I'm not being completely rejected. I agree, Aaron. I think to see Benji would be marvellous. I think he's a character that we've come to know and love. I wonder if he's going to always keep that really easily identifiable wrinkly forehead. I don't think so. I don't think that he is. I think he's going to change. But hopefully we will be able to watch Benji grow up and become a big, strong elephant bull. At the moment, he just looks like he's got lots and lots of concerns and quite possibly the world upon his shoulders. This elephant, on the other hand, the only responsibility she's feeling at the moment is munching away on the black monkey thorn. Chandra, I don't know, can you see that elephant that's in front? Oh, no, it's stopped doing it now. It's, hasn't been terribly successful in its sickle bush eating habits. But I think we're in the wrong place and we can't move. While we're watching this herd with lots of little elephant calves wandering about, you'll notice some of them, particularly the one that was charging the vehicle earlier, didn't have any tusks. And Abhishek, welcome to the Sunset Safari. It's wonderful to have you on board and to receive your question. You wanted to know what age an elephant's tusks will start growing. They'll start poking through at usually around 3 or so years old, possibly just a little bit before, possibly a little just a little bit after. Like kids, it depends on the individual itself. So you know how some kids lose their teeth earlier than others, or grow their permanent teeth earlier than others? Oh, a little baby elephant is like that. The interesting thing about that is that little baby elephants actually have milk tusks in the same way children have milk teeth, but you don't actually see them. They don't protrude beyond the lip. As they are modified teeth. That is what a tusk is. A tusk is a tooth, but a very long tooth, very specialized tooth. And a very, very solid one. And then some elephants, of course, as we saw this morning, with the tuskless females, some elephants, a very small percentage of them, don't get tusks at all. They just never grow. And they're surrounded by, not surrounded, we've got just the sounds, accompanied to the sounds of elephants feeding absolutely everywhere, munching away. And it's such a peaceful sound, it almost lulls one to sleep. Just that gentle crunching. I think she is going to move off, and I'm too scared to reposition to get us in a better place without losing our signal. We'll content ourselves for now watching this colossus of the African bush devour her lunch. Still looking fine. I know a lot of you have commented on the fact that we're seeing quite a few skinny elephants. Most of them are looking okay. Bones not too prominent, even though we are in the middle of the dry season after a prolonged drought. They're still looking absolutely fine. Hey, big girl. Oh, the nice thing about cheetah plains is it carries with it enormous potential for lots of marvellous elephant sightings. I think we should go and try and find one where we don't run the risk of losing our signal. And while we do that, let's go back across to the wonderful Mr. Hendry, find out how his day, if his day could get any better than it has already been.
My day couldn't really get any better, but for being allowed, of course, to talk in baby talk, which I'm not going to do now. We're heading towards Biffleshoek Dam. We might maybe see some elephants there. I suspect quite strongly what we're going to see there is some buffalo, maybe a grey heron, and possibly a waterbuck, and maybe Biffleshoek Bob, the bachelor of the dam. You see how I changed it up there, Brian? Thank you very much. We might also see Pinchy Wiener's friends. Anyway, we're not too far from there. And as we drive down this little patch of woodland, I'm reminded, of course, that Brian and I are going on leave as of tomorrow, and this is going to look immeasurably different in 2 weeks' time. There's going to be much, much less in the way of foliage on these leaves, and I don't know, I think I'm always excited to get back and see how it's changed. Because you don't, you know, I mean, of course, all of you know that you don't notice these changes as they happen. Hello, Andrew Firestone. You're a new viewer and you say, is it autumn here in South Africa? No, Andrew, it's not autumn. We're in full-blown winter in the same way that the Northern Hemisphere is in full-blown summer. And I guess the reason you're thinking it's autumn, perhaps, is that these leaves, or the trees, still have maintained some of their leaves. And interestingly, as we go into springtime, we get lots of wind blowing through this area, and that's when the trees lose their leaves. Because it doesn't get especially cold here, Andrew, what happens is that the leaves actually last longer than they would in the Northern Hemisphere, and they continue to photosynthesize for a few months after the autumn and probably into the winter as well. And then they lose their leaves in the driest part of the season, which is in August and September and into October, and then all the leaves come back after that. So although it looks like it's autumn, it isn't. It's full-blown winter, and we get that kind of wintry look where all the trees that look like skeletons a bit later on. Ooh, there's a zebra just up ahead. He went trotting off. There he is. He thought he could escape us, Brian, but he cannot. There he is. Looks like a lone fellow. No, there's another one going off behind him. This will be the stallion. I say that with confidence, and it is a stallion. Phew. Now, he may be part of a little group of two or three stallions that are not quite old enough to have their own harem yet. Or he might be the harem leader, in which case his oldest wife will be leading the herd through the woodland, and he'll be standing behind here. That's largely because any threat that could assail them would most likely come from behind, and he being the larger of the group, he is best equipped to deal with the threat. Right, let us go through here. There are some buffalo, as predicted. Bob, the bachelor of Buffalo's Hook, is indeed in attendance. All we're missing now is the grey heron. No, gypsum geese we got. We don't see any grey heron, though. I was wrong, Brian.
James, you can't be right all the time.
I know. But this water is drying very fast, and I think by the time Brian and I return in 2 weeks' time, there will be no water left here, maybe a small puddle. And then it will not be a particularly productive place to come and visit. Now, on Bob's back, many of you may notice, is a group of terrapins. They are freshwater turtles. Well, as much as you can describe this water as fresh, it's fresh in so much as it's not salty. But it certainly isn't something you'd like to drink, not unless you could avail yourself of a public convenience very soon thereafter. And they are big. Those are really big, serrated, hinged terrapins. They're probably about a foot in diameter. They're probably about that wide. So they really are pretty big. And quite heavy, and they're quite fat too. So I wonder, maybe the younger ones don't make it quite so easily after the water gets dry like this. It's quite possible they get eaten by birds and that sort of thing, and that only the really big ones like this get through a difficult dry season. And they're sunning themselves, of course, because it is winter. They don't want to be too cold. They find it very difficult to move when it's cold, because they are, of course, ectothermic. In other words, they're cold-blooded. And the other thing they do is eat off the ectoparasites from the hippo. So in much the same way as you can see there's some squirrels alarm calling. In much the same way that the oxpeckers are sitting on the buffalo behind the hippo, eating off the ectoparasites and the ticks there, so it is that the terrapins will be eating off the ectoparasites on the hippo. I'm going to just sit here for a little bit longer and see what happens with those alarm calling squirrels. Jamie has managed to find herself some signal and some more elephants. New elephants. The link has been cancelled. We're still here. You can wait with me and see what happens with the I've lost my train of thought slightly. Ah, yes. There is a buffalo. And sorry, everyone. I got completely flummoxed. I shouldn't have been flummoxed, of course. I should be able to handle that entirely. Ah, Pinchy Wiener, you've sent through a tweet. Thank you, Pinchy. You say I can stop by for a visit at any time. That's very kind, Pinchy. I might do that. Thank you very much. If you could send your address, that would be great. Now, Brian, the other thing here, of course, these two Egyptian geese. And if there was ever an advertisement for not to get married, well, Egyptian geese provide it. They do nothing but argue with each other, and when they aren't arguing with each other, what they do here is stand one of them looking like it's sulking, the other with its back turned, feeding. So it looks like the most appalling domestic arrangement that the Egyptian geese have. Normally they're standing staring at each other going, quack, 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 or they're flying around the dam here, one of them chasing the other, shouting very loudly. There are plenty of examples of animals that show a much better examples of marital bliss than the Egyptian goose, but the Egyptian geese, really bad example for monogamy. Look at them. You can see they've just had a spat, and they don't know what to say to each other. There's quite a lot of alarm calling going on just north of the dam here. I think it's going to be worth sitting here just to see what happens. I wonder if there isn't a predator coming down here to have a drink. We don't know where that Nkuhuma lioness with the three older cubs is. Hello, Abhishek, and you're wondering about the terrapins there and you want to know if they're like tortoises. They are like tortoises. Abhishek, there are three kinds of what we call chelonians, and chelonians are the shelled reptiles, turtles, tortoises, tortoises, and terrapins. Tortoises live on land. They don't swim. They can swim a little bit if they have to. Terrapins live in fresh water like that, and turtles live in the sea. Now, these particular terrapins, the serrated hinged terrapin, are easily distinguished from tortoises, A, because, well, they're in the water and standing on the back of a hippo, which you wouldn't find a tortoise doing. And also, I mean, you can't see from here. Oh, dear. I'm going to get tossed off. Also, by the fact that their heads retract sideways into the shell rather than straight back, which is what happens with a tortoise. So, Abhishek, that's the main difference. They also, terrapins tend to be carnivorous, so they'll eat ectoparasites and things like that. They'll also eat small fish. They'll probably eat small reptiles. They sometimes grab birds that come down to drink, and so they tend to be a lot more carnivorous, where the tortoises are normally almost entirely herbivorous. But for the speaks-hinged tortoise, which fancies the odd bit of escargot. They like to eat the giant land snails every so often. I suspect more for the calcium provided by the shell of the snail rather than for the delicious flavour of the snotty consistency that is inevitable when you eat a snail. Book Diva, you want to know how come it is that hippo allows those very large terrapins to stand on his back? Book Diva, I suspect for the same reason that I sometimes just allow flies to sit on my head. It tickles and it feels nice. I'm being slightly facetious here. I don't think that they have any effect on him. I think he's just got used to them. I suspect the first time a terrapin climbs on the back of a hippo, he probably shakes them off and gets a bit of a fright. But eventually they just realize there's no harm done. And, well, in the same way that a buffalo allows an oxpecker or sometimes a cattle egret, which, you know, doesn't eat ticks off it, but sometimes you'll find a cattle egret standing on top of a buffalo or a heron standing on top of a hippo. They don't have any effect on them. And I actually suspect quite strongly that it feels quite nice to have them walking about on top there. Probably just gives them a little bit of a tickle. You like a back tickle every so often, Brian?
I love it.
Yes, you see. Mm. I find the same. Not that I've ever had oxpeckers or terrapins crawling around on my back or on my head. All right, that's enough of that. Let's move on. I'm going to just stick my head down the northern end of the dam, see if there isn't anything coming this way. The completely relaxed nature, however, of those buffalo bulls indicates that were a pride of lions to be coming this way, well, they're very confident in themselves, or there isn't a pride of lions coming this way. It's a stunning, very peaceful little scene there. This is a wonderful opportunity. Wait for it, everybody. Now, Marianne, you're in Texas and you're wondering about what's going on at the Juma Dam Cam. Now, Louise is going to show you what's going on at the Juma Dam Cam. Louise, tell me when you're there. Now, there you will see two water monitors, and those water monitors apparently are in the business of creating more water monitors. So they have been mating with great enthusiasm for much of the afternoon. And Marianne, you want to know how long they will keep that up for. To be honest with you, Marianne, I couldn't possibly tell you. I suspect quite strongly, though, that they're mating now. I'm just opening a book here to see if I can get you a little bit of information. But I suspect they're mating now. No, they are mating now. Good grief, the male seems to be drowning the female. That sounds horrid. I suspect that she will lay her eggs fairly soon. And they lay up 20 to 60 eggs. I'm reading to you now, of course. I'd love to tell you that I'd remembered all this, but I didn't. And the reason I wanted to look at that is that they hatch in 4 to 6 months after they laid. So that will be in the height of the summertime, when they are eventually hatched. So, yeah, that's quite interesting. For 20 to 60 eggs laid in a termite mound. They'll go and find a termite mound somewhere close by. They'll mate in that. No, not mate in that. She'll lay her eggs there. And 4 to 6 months later, the little ones will be born. I suspect 4 months from now, of course, will take us to, well, November or December. So, yeah, that's why they'll do it. Height of the summertime. And Kerry, you have been watching that rather than anything going on here, and you say they've been mating for over 30 minutes. That is quite impressive, I must confess. I think most of the reptiles actually take quite a long time for their conjugal visits, as it were. And yeah, that doesn't surprise me at all. Crocodiles take ages over it. I'm not sure how long it will go on for. I suspect a couple of hours. And remember, of course, they're in the water, it's chilly, they're ectothermic in exactly the same way that those terrapins are ectothermic, which means that all of the heat that they have must come from the environment, which means that they are cold, and so it's going to be difficult for them to move with any kind of speed. And so I think anything going on there is going to be happening very slowly. And it's quite interesting there. Apparently the female is rising, the male struggling to hold on. I'm going to ask Louise how she's identifying one from the other. I don't think I'd be able to identify one from the other. Saved because, of course, they're not equipped. I'm not assuming, at least I think, if I'm not mistaken, no, hang on, I'm wrong. Yes, he does have, I think he's got what we call a hemipenis, which is a penis that splits in two at the end. And I think they do have that. Some reptiles don't, and many birds don't, of course, and they just sort of join their cloacal openings together. So it's very difficult to tell who's male and who's female. But I think Louise is probably correct there. I, of course, cannot see what's going on there. I'm having it narrated to me. I think it's wonderful that we were able to see that at the Juma Dam Pan. So keep an eye there. And Louise says they now look like the Loch Ness Monster, which I think is quite amusing. I am currently driving around the Buffelshoek Dam just to see if I can see what those squirrels were alarming at, see if the other lioness isn't around here somewhere. While you are watching mating lizards. So we've just come to the other side of the dam here, just to see if there isn't any evidence of perhaps another lion lying in the shade with three other little cubs. But I haven't seen anything here, and I haven't... Ooh, there's plenty of tracking. One track. One lioness here. No cub tracks, though, so I'm sure it's that lioness who comes down to have a drink here every so often. Sorry, beefy buffaloes, we're going to disturb you slightly as we come past. I do apologise. In fact, this is quite a nice view, isn't it, Brian? A view of our beefies and of Bob and his free riders. He's watching us. He doesn't like it when we get too close to his old Bob. He starts to move away, or he stands up and shows us the full extent of his impressive 2.5 tons. That's 2,500 kilograms, about 6,000 pounds. So they get very, very large indeed. This Land Rover that we're on weighs 1.6 tons when it's unladen. With Brian and the equipment on it, it weighs probably a maximum of 2 tons, so that hippopotamus substantially heavier than we are here. He's very relaxed at the moment. And Pam, you ask a very, very good question, of course, about Bob the hippo and what is likely to happen to him when his waterhole dries up. Pam, he's in for a tough time, I'm afraid. You know, he's only here, I suspect, because most of the other habitat's been taken by other hippos. And so he's going to have to find some other water. There isn't any big enough to hold him on Juma, well, except at the Juma Dam Pan, and I know we had a hippo there, and we had a hippo at the Gallagher waterhole some time back during the height of the summer drought. And that's probably what he'll do. But, you know, during the drought season, there have been quite a few deaths of hippopotamus in the Kruger Park, and that's because they just don't have the habitat to be in. And so, yeah, it's a slightly bleak future for him, unless we get some nice early rains. Because I suspect he's just not quite big enough to take a territory in more salubrious environs. What is wrong with this buffalo's nose here, Brian? Oh, nothing. He just says that he's got quite a lot. He's just got quite a lot of a fur underneath his chin. See that, Brian?
I do.
He's got quite an impressive beard.
A goatee.
He's got a goatee, even though he's a buffalo. And a bit of stick and grass attached to the snot coming out of his left nostril.
Oh, lovely.
Especially impressive shining as it is in the lovely setting sun. Would you like to look at these snotty buffalo a bit more, Brian, or shall we move on?
We can move on.
I think we should move on. Okay, here we go. Alice, you're in Ohio and you ask a very good question. I'm going to stop here simply because it's actually quite a nice shot of two buffalo with a hippopotamus in between. Alice, you're in Ohio and you say, what would all the animals do without the termite mounds, given the fact that they are, everything seems to use them. The wild dogs use them, the hyenas use them, The hyenas use them, the lizards use them, everything uses them to live in or to give birth in. And Alice, the answer is, well, they'd really struggle, wouldn't they? They are really a very important source of home for many, many creatures, including one of the other chelonians, or the other chelonians being the speaks hinge tortoise, and that's one of the tortoise species that we get here. And they live for the winter in the middle of those termite mounds. So yeah, lots and lots of things live there, and there's such, the reason so many things live in them is because they're so beautifully well insulated. They're brilliantly designed. He likes us a bit more, that one, I think, Brian. He's also got snot coming out of his nose. He's got a cold.
It is winter.
It is winter, yes, as we all know. One shouldn't judge him too harshly. He does look so very cross. And you, some of you, I think, are probably wondering what that white stuff on his chin is. The white stuff is simply saliva. He's not rabid. And it's saliva that is sort of foaming because they chew all the time, of course. They have to chew and chew and chew when they've got their cud coming up. And so he's been chewing the cud, and that's just left that foam there. That snotty nose, although I'm being slightly facetious about it, doesn't look great to me, I must say. And we know that the buffalo of the Kruger National Park do carry bovine tuberculosis. I've got no idea if that's got something to do with that or not. But as drought conditions persist and life becomes difficult for them, so symptoms of TB might be expressed. Now, I don't know what that is or whether that is or isn't a symptom of TB. While we look at that, he obviously doesn't think it is. You see, he's giving me a very dirty look indeed. Jamie is on Cheetah Plains, and this time I believe she has found some more elephants.
It's a huge relief to hear that the buffalo is rabies-free. Our elephants are also rabies-free, as far as I can tell. But I will say that they are incredibly numerous on Cheetah Plains this afternoon, which is sort of what we predicted. I actually didn't mean to stop here. I was going to rush around because there's a herd racing towards Three in a Row Pan to go and have a drink. But I have hit an elephant roadblock. Not actually hit, but I have encountered an elephant roadblock. And since it is such a beautiful afternoon, we can spend some time watching them before they give us a chance to drive past and back across to Three in a Row Pan, which is actually Two in a Row Pan today, as we confirmed this morning. A female straggling at the back. There's a huge herd that ran past us earlier. Absolutely enormous. There must have been about 40 elephants. Oh, we've got some more crossing the road in front of us. I think this is most likely a separate herd, but they've all joined together. And that's the lovely thing about elephants, is that there's no real set in territories or defined structures. There's no elephant herds that don't like each other. Everybody in an elephant herd generally gets along with everybody else, as long as they remember their place. Round little one. Mommy gone. And hello to Mary Edwards as we saw that young calf dash across and we spoke about the age at which elephants start growing tusks. And I mentioned the fact that not every elephant will grow tusks inevitably, that there is a genetic abnormality that causes them to be born tuskless. Mary Edmonds, yes, it is caused by a genetic abnormality. Hello. The normal population size, or the proportion of elephants born without tusks is actually very, very low. It's around 4% of all elephants that are born naturally without tusks at all. Unfortunately, as human beings, not in this area, but if you go further north into Africa, as human beings, we've artificially increased that number just due to poaching problems for elephants with tusks. Obviously, that selects for those without. That's not a problem here. We do get one or two little individuals, or big individuals, that don't have any tusks. There's a couple of large females without them. There is at least one large male that we know of without any tusks. Ooh, somebody's trumpeting at the back. We've heard where those sounds emanate from because we saw that incredible sighting just a few days ago where a female elephant pushed over and pinned down a young male as a way of disciplining him. I don't know what he did. I think he gave her a little bit of cheek. And we do occasionally see them without tusks, but the little ones that we're seeing now, Mary, are just without tusks because they haven't grown yet. They only start to show through at about 3 years old. My goodness me, not that I'm ever one to complain about a lack or about too many elephants. I'm thrilled that there are as many elephants as there are, but there really are lots and lots of elephants on Cheetah Plains. It is quite extraordinary. Can hear them everywhere. Oh, hello, little one. And that, of course, is because they're all coming in from the Kruger National Park because there's water here. And that is why they're coming here. That we've got them all around us. Little calf off to our right. And then just a sort of screen of disappearing grey bottoms against the outline of the trees. It's simply marvellous. Andre, there's a little one that I think he's going to stop doing it, but it's a little one doing ballet. That little one straight ahead was a little bit too, yeah, that's the one. There we go. He was doing ballet, but I think it stopped for now, or resting its little feet, resting its weight on one hip. But it was doing little attitudes and little dance moves. Baby elephants are always tremendously entertaining to watch, especially when they learn to use their trunks, which doesn't come straight away. It comes with practice. Now, Michael, there are no bones in an elephant's trunk. There are somewhere between 50 to 100,000 muscles, though, in a really complex structure. They're sort of horizontal, vertical, and cross bands. Oh, there we go. He's doing ballet again. Itchy ankle. Almost, little one. Yes, you get that tree. You get it. Show it to his boss. Now, Jerry, of course, in final control, disagrees with me that the baby elephant is doing ballet. She thinks it is doing the tree pose. Which makes it yoga-related rather than ballet-related. Certainly when I was a little girl, there were no yoga classes for children. I have no doubt that that has changed these days. So perhaps Jerry is right. Perhaps our little one, even at a tender age of a couple of months old, is doing yoga. Jerry, I disagree. I think it was ballet. All right. Let us go and catch up with the rest of the herd. Michael, that amazing movement of the trunk, as I said, is this really complex combination of muscles. That is absolutely fascinating to look at. And when you think of what a trunk is capable of, it's capable of tearing off branches, pushing down trees, and at the same time delicate enough to accordion or concertina forward, pick something up that could be the size of a toothpick in between the two lips of the trunk. And the most astounding result of years and years or thousands of years of evolution to create the trunk, and there's nothing like it out here. The elephant is the only animal with this phenomenal proboscis-like extension of its face. It's something that is truly fascinating to watch elephants use. Their level of dexterity, less so for the little ones, they've got to practice. Just like toddlers have to practice using their hands. But it is, I think, one of the things that fascinates people the most about elephants. Oh, did you get something in your eye, little one? Oh, I don't think you would have been able to hear that. But most of you will know, by the way, that little elephant has got his friend. Got a fork-tailed drongo fluttering about, picking up any insects that this little elephant happens to disturb. Now, I'm not sure any of you could hear that. There was that deep, deep rumble that elephants use to communicate, and which I find innately comforting whenever I hear it. That was a particularly low rumble that one of the females gave, and I say it was one of the females, I think it was. Usually the older females use it to communicate with the rest of the herd and also to provide sort of comfort and contact, especially when they're spread out like this. Occasionally you get pairs like this left behind, distracted by a particularly juicy tree. Hello to you, Daniel! While we watch our little baby elephant, and welcome to our live safaris. It is marvellous to have you on board, Daniel, and I'm so glad you get to share in this elephant sighting with us. Daniel is wanting to know a little bit more about when an air baby elephant is born. Oh, you're going to chase the drongo now, little one. That will be very unproductive. So, Daniel, they weigh, depending upon where you are from, and forgive my conversion rates, between just around 100 kilograms or just under. That will depend, just like human beings, upon the individual mother and calf, but around 100 kilograms or just under 220 odd pounds is how much a baby elephant will weigh. So they look tiny, but you certainly wouldn't want to get involved in a collision with one. And that can range, by the way. That sort of 100 kilograms is the maximum that you will get an elephant calf weighing. And they grow exceptionally rapidly in their first 10 or so years of life, or especially in their first 5 or so years of life. Hello to Tasha. Speaking of the elephant's anatomy, we've chatted a bit about, we've touched on their marvellous trunk, or their tremendous trunk, and now on to their elephantine ears. No, that didn't work, sorry. Anyway, moving on very rapidly. Tasha, in terms of their ears, no, they're not made up mainly of cartilage, although they do have a little bit of cartilage in their ears, but most of it is skin, but also blood vessels. So, Tasha, I'm sure that you know that the elephant's ear is its air conditioning unit. Well, if you didn't, I'm telling you now. In other words, it's the way in which an elephant cools down. So what is in that ear mostly is blood vessels. There's a strip of cartilage that holds its shape, and then most of that is a dense network of capillaries to bring the blood close to the surface of the ear. So when they flap them like that, they're not saying I'm angry. They're basically telling you that they're hot and they're trying to cool down. with a tremendous amount of blood that pumps through those enormous ears with that enormous surface area, it allows them to rapidly cool down. I'm hoping we haven't missed our herd drinking at two in a row pan, a different herd, the herd that came running across. I do want to scoot forward and go and investigate that. In the meantime, let's go across to James, who has got probably the antelope that wins prizes for being the best looking.
There is an antelope that wins the best prize for being the best looking, everybody. As Jamie said, it is a Nyala, of course, a beautiful Nyala bull. And he was, just before you came across here, eating a bone. And I'm going to go and retrieve that bone once he's moved off so that I might show it to you. And you should marvel at the fact that that Nyala thinks that it is a hyena. Doesn't it, Brian? It was even whooping like a hyena, wasn't it?
It was.
Don't be ridiculous.
It was. I heard it.
It's going to be all gobby, Brian. Standard issue bone, everybody, and this is what the Nyala was eating. And indeed, you can see it, the glistening of the Nyala saliva there. Can you see it, Brian? Not really, no.
No,
wrong side of the light, really, isn't it? Yes. Anyway, it's not unusual. It's completely common, of course, for Nyala, especially this time of the year, to eat bones. Nyala are particularly fond of it, but many other antelope as well will suck on these bones. Apparently, it is largely for phosphorus, but also for calcium that they get out of these bones. And of course, that's because it's just simply not enough of it in the foliage that they eat.
Can you see his teeth marks?
I cannot see his teeth marks because I think they do more sucking than chewing. You know, being blessed with teeth rather like ours. And I'm not really going to do that. It would be quite dangerous, I think, for us as human beings to be trying to put these sorts of things in our mouths. We don't have the digestive enzymes to cope with whatever bacteria could be on here. It was broken open by a hyena at some stage, and the hyena would have sucked the marrow out, would have been very rich in fat, very good for hyena. And now the bone, of course, despite the fact that whatever hapless animal it was killed somewhere here some time back, gave its life. It is still giving to the wilderness as we speak. On we go, Brian. See if we can find a leopard. I said to Brian, would you like to see a leopard? And he said, yes, he would. So that's what we're going to try and find. But I haven't seen any sight or sign of a leopard. Hello, Tony. Tony, you're wondering how Nigel's doing. Now, for those of you who don't know, Nigel was a Nyala that was eaten by, I think, killed by Tingana, and then he was eaten by some lions. And we found him with his horns intact and his jaw still attached to his top, but just his spinal column. The rest of it was gone. And Brian and I, we did a little segment where Nigel was pretending to narrate his own death, because as I held him by his horns and moved him around, his jaw moved up and down and it looked like he was talking. So we narrated his death through his own voice, really. And we then put him in a plastic container full of flesh-eating beetles. And Tony, you're wondering, has he been cleaned of all of his flesh? He hasn't yet, and it's because it's winter, and what Yuri describes, Yuri the landowner here, what he describes is the committee, and the committee is what he refers to as the collection of beetles he has. The committee has not been very busy of late because it's been cold, and they haven't been breeding much because he hasn't been clearing up many skeletons of late. But there were a few members of the committee left, and Nigel is doing his very best to reignite their existence. So he's still in his plastic casing full of beetles, and hopefully sometime soon we'll be able to show you to him. All right, Jamie's predictions of elephants drinking has come true. Let's go and take a look.
When I was a child, there was this incredible advert in South Africa on South African television for one of the paints companies. I can't remember what it was. And it was two elephants having a marvelous mud bath to a very catchy tune. And I cannot help but be reminded of that particular advert right now when we've got two young bulls having a marvelous time and providing us with such a stunning scene at 3-in-a-row/2-in-a-row pan on cheetah plains. I'm going right into the muddy water to get to the best possible spots to quench their thirst. Nobody's all that keen on actually soaking themselves. It's not that warm this afternoon. While we enjoy this incredible view, Janae has been carefully observing our elephants' drinking behavior and has noticed the strange tendency of them to blow bubbles. Well, Janae, the reason that they do that is often to clear away scum on the top of the water or sand on the top of the water. That might be one way. They also flick, they sort of siphon off the dirty water and then get to the clean water underneath. The elephants are quite fussy drinkers. But that being said, sometimes they just do it because it's fun. They do it because they enjoy it. And that's the marvelous thing about elephants, is they entertain themselves. They've got so much going on in those minds of theirs, and sometimes blowing bubbles or squelching through the mud is a way of alleviating a little bit of the boredom of the day-to-day life. What do you think, boy, as you squelch your way out with your mud boots? Very gracefully done. You better hurry up, the rest of your herd has left you behind. He's in no hurry. He's got the teenage saunter down. The quiet insouciance of a teenage male elephant. I still hear some talking happening from the other side, but these two are too old and grown up for that. They're just going to subtly move behind the rest of the herd. Now that all-purpose trunk used for drinking, eating, blowing bubbles for fun, sniffing other elephants, touching other elephants, whatever else it happens to be. Nisha, yes, one of the things that they do use it for is breathing, like a nose, like we breathe through our noses. And they regularly do that. And in fact, an elephant is one of the few animals that is basically able to completely submerge itself. I'm talking land mammals, that is. Able to completely submerge itself and use the trunk as a snorkel. How cool is that? That's how elephants in Botswana and places where there's huge bodies of water, that's how they cross those bodies of water. They can swim. They're very good. I wouldn't call them... Look, they're not going to win any. Oh. Hello. Our elephants are coming, sneaking up behind us for a drink as well. How wonderful. Hello, everybody. It's okay, don't mind me. I'm sorry, I've planted myself right here. Told you, this place is teeming with elephants. Today's an elephant-filled afternoon. Hi, guys. Come have a drink, don't mind me. They're parting around us on either side like an ocean or a river. There we go. There we go. Don't mind us. My apologies. You're all coming to go and have a drink in the dam. Nicely, big girl. Those of you who are familiar with our VR will be aware of what we're doing now. It's our virtual reality rig. And we're going to be doing that at the same time. Although, to be honest, Jandre, I think the moment might have passed. I think they have all gone past us. I could hear Chandra frantically getting it ready. And the two little elephants racing off after each other. And a quieting rumble off from the female on the right. They don't want to drink here. They want to go further on, although this one cow is going to stop here. But I think most of them aiming for the other pan. It hasn't been quite so sullied by elephants stomping around in the water. Okay, is that beeping at me to say I stopped recording? Perfect. Okay. Oh, this is so beautiful. Before I do reposition to catch up with them, this is such a beautiful view. As I said, elephants everywhere. It's such an iconic shot. Departing bottoms. Of all sizes. Okay, let's go a bit closer. Go and join them whilst they have a drink. Most of you know I absolutely love elephants, and spending time with them, no matter what the mood, is always an incredibly fulfilling and enriching experience. Let's go and watch them try and poke their noses over the dam wall. They'd poke their trunks. It's a pity quarantine isn't here to watch them go wandering past. Oh, that was, what's the word? But this, shame. I know that they are led by the females in each herd, the older and most experienced. They've just walked straight past the water, so they're not thirsty. And of course they're hungry, they need to eat pretty much constantly. But what makes them decide, okay, today we are going to the northern side of Mala Mala? I mean, they're striding forward, they're on a mission. They're going somewhere. What's been said? What's going on in their brains that has they've decided that this is now time to move, not time to stand and feed for ages on a bush willow? I wish I could spend today existence. As for Waterbuck, well, I'm not entirely sure, but let's go and see if we can't figure out what this one is thinking about.
It's party time.
And it seems as though, unfortunately, James couldn't hear anything that poor Lou was trying to tell him. Oh, let us go and catch up with our elephant herd while James attempts to figure out his ability to hear final control. We're going to leave our elephant herd for now and watch them disappear off into the distance. By the disappearing elephants for me to put on a jacket because it's quite chilly now. Now just bear with me one moment. I'm just going to hop onto the Game Drive channel and try and get hold of James, for it seems as though he has disappeared off the radar completely. Sorry, Mike. Interrupt him mid-sentence. My mistake. Sorry about that, Mike. James for Jamie. Oh, nope, James has gone rogue. He He's... Oh, there he is. I'm calling you, James. Is back, and he be comforted with the knowledge that he will be easily contactable very, very shortly through the normal route. I will allow James to explain that to you when he next sees you. But he will be imminently contactable. Whoopsies. Oh well, joys of live safaris. Sometimes things go wrong, sometimes you get an unexpectedly behind the scenes view. And unexpectedly and often unintentional behind the scenes view. Oh well, James figures out his radio situation. You can travel along with me to the Cheetah Plains clearings. And there we go. Oh, all is well. The Inyala is still around. Let's go to James.
I do apologize, everybody. I managed to hit the radio so that I was on the completely wrong channel. I'm very pleased that neither Brian nor I said anything untoward during our last segment, which we were unaware of course. We are now looking at a very large herd of Nyala making their way. Well, I'm not sure where they're going. They might be going down towards the Juma Pan. Sorry, I saw some fast movement and I thought it might be wild dogs. It isn't, it is a vehicle. And you can just see their lovely, lovely colours as the sun sets. These, of course, the females of that magnificent bull we saw earlier chewing on his bone. I think they're looking pretty good, Nick. I don't think they're looking like they're suffering at all as a result of the dryness. So they're obviously finding sufficient bones to suck on and sufficient leaves to eat. Now I say it's a large herd because normally it's sort of 4 or 5 females maybe, and there are a few here, there are 4 or 5 here plus a bull, and then a whole lot more have just crossed the road in front of us with some calves. I'm not going to go forward because they'll get a bit of a fright. We'll just sit here and watch them cross the road in their superbly elegant fashion. Don't you think they're elegant, Brian?
So elegant.
Almost as elegant as Brian is tall. Oh, and I don't know if you can hear in the background, there is a crested barbet calling. Hello, Pierre. Nice question from you about territoriality. And you say, are these antelope territorial? Sometimes they are. And if you impala are territorial during the rut, so when they're trying to mate, they make a little territory and they try and herd the females into it. Wildebeest the same, they become territorial during mating season. And the Nyala will to a certain extent, but largely they're not. They don't have permanent territories, and their territories and home ranges shrink and swell depending on the conditions. Depending on how much water there is, how much vegetation there is for them to eat. They are water dependent, and so their territories will shrink. They can't afford to be too territorial. If water, for example, is as concentrated as it is now. I'm always quite interested in what they're eating. A very, very good question from Aaron in Florida, and I think I know the answer to it. You say, would different antelope species fight with each other? Aaron, I'm going to say no, and the reason I'm going to say no is because they're normally completely different sizes. So a Nyala would very seldom try and take on a kudu. Well, in fact, I don't think he'd ever take on a kudu bull because a kudu bull is much bigger than him. Likewise, a bushbuck, which is the other tragaleiphid or spiral-horned antelope that we get here, well, they wouldn't take on a Nyala because a Nyala is that much bigger. I don't think an impala would take on a Nyala. They have separate kind of feeding niches, so they wouldn't take each other on. Diker and Steenbok, likewise, they're different sizes, slightly different feeding niches. There's no real reason for them to take each other on, except maybe over water, but there the size difference, I think, would preclude it. If you're bigger, the bigger you are, the more you get to, or the more premier your position becomes at a drinking hole. So I think that's pretty much what happens. I've never seen inter-antelope species fighting. Speaking of another antelope, there's an impala, ram. Now, to me, he looks a lot more ropey. In fact, he looks very ropey. Much more ropey than the nyalas. And I think there's a good reason for that. I think that you'll find that many animals out here, of course, some of them will show or be carrying diseases in a parasite load that perhaps wouldn't affect them at all were it not for the fact that they're now struggling to find enough to eat. So only the strongest animals are going to survive if the drought continues. And therefore, that's the other reason that impala is looking ropey, is that he's chasing girls around, which means that he will be forgetting to eat. There's a beautiful bull, nyala bull there, with some impala cow in the middle, and then another nyala cow behind. There you can see the wonderful difference between the two. And that's not three species you're looking at, it's only two. Male nyala, female nyala, and female impala. And oxpecker having mud bath. Not mud bath, dust bath, sorry. James Dungan, you've asked a question to which there are about 7,000 theories, none of which I think hold particularly good water. You say, why do antelope like nyala have white spots around their mouths? I don't know, James. One of the theories with the kudu, or not the kudu, the nyala, is that they have white tips to the horns and those white chevrons and dots under their noses, and they can size each other up by judging the distance between those white dots and the white tips to the horns. I think that's utter nonsense. I think they size each other up without such a ridiculously complex method there. So I don't know. I think it's probably got much to do with them being disguised or trying to camouflage themselves. They live in dappled light always. They live in thick bush fringing drainage lines where the light is dappled. And so what I think they try and do is sort of blend in with that in much the same way that a leopard does. Right, Jamie, the elephant whisperer of Juma, has got some more elephants. Let's go and look.
Oh goodness, we do. We've got elephants everywhere. There's more coming. They're doing their water walk. There's another word, Jadre. Water, 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 water. I'm so thirsty, I'm so thirsty, I'm so thirsty, I'm so thirsty. Oh, distraction, but water. Okay, all right, I'll calm down a little bit. Oh, this has been such a wonderful afternoon, surrounded by elephants having a drink. And I think this is the place to be, Cheetah Plains Pan. Well, you thirsty little one, careful. Don't rush into things, you might fall down. It just goes to never forget that an elephant is phenomenally nimble. They are nimble creatures. Okay, I mean, they're not as nimble as, say, a dainty genet or something. But they certainly are capable of going anywhere that a human being is capable of going on two legs. And they are rushing to water to have their long-awaited drink. And I actually think this might even be the herd that we saw earlier that skipped past a cheetah plain, or three-in-a-row pan, in order to come to the freshly pumped Cheetah Plains Pan. I think the water here is cleaner. And so the little ones were extra specially thirsty. Oh, is that better, little one? Slurping up trunkfuls of water. No, that wouldn't be the plural, would it? It would be trunks full of water. And putting it into their mouths. Oh, occasionally rejecting the odd bit. This is such a beautiful scene. It really is. And at the back there, although you can't see it, because we've got the perfect combination of heights, It is definitely our elephants from earlier. There's that elephant with a half an ear that you unfortunately didn't see, but I did when they raced past. But what I was going to say was, if you look at the back, there's two little calves of the same age, and they were both there with a female. Oh, girls. Aren't you marvellous? Oh, almost, almost. Push! There you go. Well done. Well done. There you go, Jandre. You might want to pop your VR back on again. You never know, just in case. Oh, no, never mind. I absolutely adore moments like this and sightings like this. Just time spent watching the elephants. They're always doing something interesting. There's just something fascinating about them, whether they're feeding or running or whatever it is that they happen to be up to. There's always something to be seen. And it's partly because they are probably the most intelligent animal after human beings. Debatable. After human beings. They're the most intelligent animal out here. Hello, guys. Come, little one. It's okay. It's okay. Is that better after a drink? Oh, yes, come. Come. Fish scary. Oh, no. It's a female. She's not going to come running up to us. It's all right, little one. You can calm down to a minor panic. Your mom isn't even vaguely concerned about us. Look at that, it just spread out everywhere. I got completely distracted, and that's what I mean. An elephant's constantly doing something. Red, the phrase an elephant never forgets. It's because one of the big reasons is it comes from this belief that because elephants are such long-lived animals, and they do have very, very long lives comparatively, up to about 60 or so years, so almost the length of the average human. And they do have very good memories. So information will be stored in their heads about where to go in terms of finding water or food. And it's information that the elephants then use to ensure the survival, particularly for the older females, to ensure the survival of the rest of their herd. And they play an enormous role in protecting them. Will an elephant never forget something? No. Not exactly. Their brains are huge. They're three times the size of a person, so proportionately ours is still larger when compared to our body size, but that's still a big brain. And they have a lot of emotional development attached to it. But will they forget something? Yes, probably. Will they remember other things? Absolutely. But the phrase actually stems from elephants finding old, disused water holes and so on. There's instinctive migratory routes, there's instinctive sniffing out of water that led to this belief that elephants... In fact, it almost led to a belief that elephants can do things like have grudges against people. And yes, they'll learn. If they are badly treated, they will learn that people are bad. But if I were to accidentally come around the corner and scare an elephant, it's not going to bear a grudge against me for the rest of our existence. I hope. That'd be very sad. And hello to, as always, one of our very special viewers, Sabrina, who is 12 years old. I'm so glad you are on our safari once again. Can elephants climb? Yes, to an extent. So what I meant was, when I said that elephants can go wherever human beings can go, so wherever you can walk without using your hands to pull yourself up or to grip or to grab anything, wherever you can use your legs to walk, an elephant can go. And I've found elephant dung on top of little mount, what we call koppies, which is a sort of a mountain made of rocks. I found elephant dung at the top of there. So it's important to remember that. I've seen an elephant climb onto a tree, onto a fallen marula tree. I also once saw a little baby elephant pull itself up by its trunk, but that's a different story. So whilst they're not climbers, they do have incredibly good proprioception and an awareness of the world around them. No, Rusty. No. Chandra is having a quiet chuckle. Ish. is right. So, well, why is it me? Why is it always me? Well, that's why the Q20's in the car. Or WD-40, depending on how you want to know. We won't go with any product placement here. While I try to turn the key once again on the furthest possible spot away from home that we could possibly be, let's go across to James, who's having a good chuckle at our situation.
I am having a good chuckle, well, internally especially, because it doesn't do to laugh publicly at one's colleagues. That might be considered bad form. It is amazing to me how Rusty does that to Jamie. She's never done it to me. Many of the other cars are a strange thing to me that they don't do to the others. But this particular incident I've never experienced with Rusty. I've never had the key refusing to turn. I've had many other problems with Rusty. Not that particular one. Now, what we're doing is driving once again past the Gallagher waterhole, and we're going to go up Mvubu Road. I don't think anyone's done that this evening, and just see if we can't pick out what it was that the bushbuck were alarming at here at Gallagher waterhole a little bit earlier. There's a beautiful picture of a greater blue-eared glossy starling. And it's going. Do you hear it, Brian?
I don't.
Did you? Yeah. I'm going to play the call anyway. It's a wonderful call. There we go. Isn't that nice? And those colours are not nearly so green and iridescent and beautiful unless it's sitting in light hitting it at roughly this angle. Ooh, and there's a golden-tailed woodpecker. Did you hear that? I can see it there. It's in the tree there, Brian. Yeah, it's in that tree on the main stem about two-thirds of the way up. No, not that tree, the one in front of it. That's the scraggly thing in front of us. Yes. Yes, and he's in. Go up a bit. There, you got him. He's there. Stop, go down. Is that as far in as you can go? There he is. Down a little and to the right. And now he's center frame. There's the golden-tailed woodpecker. You can just see the beak moving a little bit there, everyone. There it is. Pecking away. Now, how do I know that's a golden-tailed woodpecker? Because of the call. It's got a very strident, very nasal call. It's not completely unlike the call of that greater blue-eared glossy starling. There we go. Isn't that nice? There we go. I don't think we've ever had as good a view of a golden-tailed woodpecker as this. I know it's not amazing, but it's pretty good for a golden-tailed woodpecker. Let's see if it calls again. You can see why we don't see them very often. Very secretive, very beautifully hidden, flown away, gone. Not going to see it again. Very nice, Brian. Well done.
Thank you, James.
Not easy, especially at the end of your work cycle.
Exactly.
Yes. Hello, Gracie, aged 8. You say those bull antelopes look like Indian chiefs. I think they do too, a little bit. I think that's wonderful that you've noticed that. And of course, you know that the Indian... Well, the reason they...
Oh, dearie me, and it seems as though 1 minute James isn't listening, the next he's disappearing completely out of signal range. As you can see, I got Rusty started. VM taught me a technique that has proved to be marvelously effective in dealing with a jammed key. So, Here we go. A mystery to be solved, or not really solved. I don't think it's so much a mystery as just an interesting little tidbit of information. One female buffalo, along with two males, and almost inevitably, when a female buffalo, oh boy, what are you giving me the dirty look for? Almost inevitably, when a female buffalo is like this with two Duggar boys, it's because at some point, the herd that she was in was chased by lions. And what happens is they get split up, and she, because of her herding instinct, she's immediately joined up with a group of males out of, well, just a desire for safety. And the other day we saw just how well that worked. We came so close to having a kill on the live safari. The lionesses of the Nkuma pride jumped on the back of a female buffalo in exactly the same sort of situation as this. It's not her, by the way. It's definitely not the one we saw before. First of all, we're too far away, and second of all, her horns are not droopy enough. But in that scenario, the lions jumped on her and injured her, not seriously, but injured her quite badly. And the buffalo bulls actually saved her life by chasing the lionesses away. And they kept coming between the injured female and the lionesses. And since there were only three lionesses, they were not successful in catching them, and the buffalo made a happy escape. And that could well be what saves this female's life, although hopefully at some point she will reconnect with the breeding herd. James Richard, you'll have to forgive me. I think I'm understanding your question correctly, but there's a little bit of fuzz on the radio this afternoon. I think James is asking about the interdigital glands between the two halves of the hooves. Yes, a lot of antelope do have them. Not really buffalo, because they don't need them so much. They're not particularly territorial. But the territorial antelope, like the wildebeest, for example, and I think we're quite close to Gormless Norman. Is it Gormless or Gormless? Never mind, I always get confused with this one. The one that Brent named, or Normal Norman, then because they're territorial, they do have the interdigital scent glands. I'm getting information that it is Gormless Norman the Gnu. We really shouldn't let Brent name things. I don't know why you lot do it. Don't let Brent name things. His name for Benjamin Button, the little elephant calf, was Old Before His Time, which certainly is super catchy. Yes, the blue wildebeest does have scent glands between his two hooves, as James Richard says, interdigital glands or pedal glands. The Steenbokkies have it, the little Dacre have it, or the territorial antelope. And there you go, there's Gnormless Gnorman the Gnu. Ridiculous. Who's in? Hands up if you're in the mood for more elephants. Okay, because they're coming this way. Oh, this is such a marvelous day. Elephants on the clearings. I wish they'd arrived just as the sun was still up. That would have been a marvelous picture. But this is still truly spectacular. What a peaceful way to spend one's afternoon. And we so often have our close-up sightings of the elephants. It's not always that we stop and view them from a distance and just take in the scene as a whole. Here's another elephant I've seen before. Awesome. Absolutely stunning. We've seen so many different elephants today. It's definitely been an elephant-filled Thursday. Anna Bushek, I know that you asked this question and I completely forgot to answer it a while ago, but now we have an opportunity once again. In terms of how fast an elephant can run, they can reach a top speed of 15 meters, 45 feet per second. That's fast. They go very, very fast. They might not look it, but they are capable of urging that tremendous bulk into very rapid forward movement. Now that equates to roughly sort of around 50 kilometers an hour, which is, what is that? I'm so bad with mile conversions. It's about, is it 30 miles per hour? 50 kilometers an hour, 30 miles. Yeah, roughly 30 miles-ish per hour. Sorry if you are from a place that uses miles. I'm much better with kilometers. Thank you very much. Andre is obviously clearly far better than I am. 31.6. Right. that definitely put me in my place, down to the decimal point. Chandra then says roughly. Let's go with meters per second. 15 meters per second, alternately 45 feet per second. They can't maintain that for a huge amount of time, but they do cover ground very, very fast. Oh, little ones. This is elephants of all sizes, and look at that. There's another herd on its way. I'm getting ridiculous. It's the little ones that were drinking at Cheetah Plains Pan. The twins, two Ellie calves of the same age. And it's not impossible that they are twins, you know. It's unlikely, but not impossible. There you go, Barry Edwards. Yes, elephants do have twins. It's very, very rare that an elephant will have twins, but it does occur. I couldn't give you an exact percentage, but I will tell you that it's very low. It's so unusual that it becomes something that is sort of, it becomes very public knowledge when an elephant is recorded to have twins, just because it's something that hardly ever happens. Same goes for giraffe as well. Once upon a time it was thought that giraffe twins were very common. It's now known that it hardly ever happens, but it does, it can occur. And a larger animal species like elephants, rhinoceros, hippopotamus, they tend to be very much a solitary offspring. Oh wow. I'll just stop here for a quick snack on a marula tree that's gone very green very quickly. Unusual for this time of year. Out of the elephants that we've seen crossing in front of us, I'm sure at least some of them would have been pregnant, and we saw them drinking as well. Michael, would a pregnant elephant need to drink more than an elephant might, than she might normally? Probably. Yes, a little bit, not a hugely discernible amount. Elephants are incredibly water-dependent creatures anyway, so they need to drink as often as possible. It's part of the digestive system and the amount of roughage that they eat. And most likely they will, a pregnant female with her 22-month gestation period will need to drink a little bit more water than usual. But I don't think that you'd notice it. I don't think she sort of rushes backwards and forwards to go and have a drink. Although, a close-on 200-pound baby, I'm sure she urinates more frequently. Such beautiful imagery. Right. I think we're done now. Oh, what you chasing, little elephant? This one here. Oh, are you chasing Brent. It's ridiculous. The elephant is chasing the wildebeest. Gormless Gnomon the Gnu. There we go. Fine, I got it. Sort of. Yeah, look, they do look a little bit like twins. Very, very unlikely, but they're about the right size. They're the same size as each other, and they've been with that mom the whole time. It's not impossible. It really isn't. I wonder. They've been... When we first arrived at Cheetah Plains Pans, they were Pan, they were together with her. They're still together with her, even though the rest of the herd is elsewhere. Might just be that it's nice to have a companion of their own age, or a similar age. Don't know. I'm hesitant to try and claim that they're twins. Might be a bit of a stretch. Our little Ellie Bull thinking about chasing our wildebeest friend. Gormless, oh for goodness sake, never mind. I really was going to genuinely try there, but I give up. Poor old Norman. Gorman. And that is something that little bull elephants do. Makes them feel big and strong and scary. Prepping them for the time where they really will be big and strong and scary. Honing that attitude. Take no nonsense. Careful, Gnorman. You're being stalked. That didn't work either. Sorry. Chandra's laughing at least. It makes me feel a bit better. I suppose we should think about... I don't actually even know what the time is anymore. But I suppose we should think about going to search as the sun starts to go down for the elusive potential brown hyena that might be around here. I mean, that is a very brave even suggestion for myself to make. But I'm really keeping my fingers crossed I might be right about that. What I should have done was asked Mike... Or Ephraim, actually Ephraim probably, he's been here longer, whether or not they've ever seen a brown hyena here. That was our massive true kings of the African bush, or queens in this case, move off into Mala Mala. Let's go back across to James, who has got something very large, but definitely not grey.
Well, brown hyena she might be able to find. If anyone can do it, Jamie can. We're back at the lions, everyone. And the male, you can see, is lying. He's thinking about getting up. And the reason he's thinking about getting up is that the females have just moved off to the north. And so what I think we're going to do is go towards them, simply because I think he will get up eventually and move towards them. So we'll get a view of him. Yeah, he's looking their way. So we'll try and follow up on the female. There's... Herbie's there driving. He's actually guiding some guests today. Watch out, everybody. Watch your heads. Don't forget to look behind. I'm just trying to reverse out of here. And I must just tell you, everyone, that the clutch on this car is threatening to go at any stage. So while I may have never had trouble with a key on Rusty, I've had many other troubles, like I said, and the clutch on this vehicle, a particular one. Now, the females have just gone off through here, so we'll see if we can find them again. Just walked through here. It's quite thick, so I didn't want to go blasting in there after them. Can you see them at all, Brian? And I think they're probably going to go north into Beefle's Hook. They, of course, you know, they get up and then they sort of lie down and then they get up and they lie down. Have you got them? Up ahead. Ah, yes. Here they come. Beautiful leonesses. And just look at them moving. Look at their colour as we stop here. Look at their colour walking through this winter vegetation. Isn't it perfect? You can see exactly why they're this colour. And that's a lovely picture of them. Beautifully hidden, totally stealthy, completely silent. And that big male, I think, is going to come out. She's of the lactating female. Where she's left her youngsters, I don't know. The usual story, Brian?
The usual story.
Thinking about going to the loo is what Brian means by that. Every time we look at an animal together, it decides to void its bowels. Getting some support from her sisters. Let's go further forward. Just go around the corner. They are probably going to cross into Biffle's Hook, everyone, like I say, which is the reserve to the north of us, if you're wondering what that is. I'm going to go all the way around the front here. And we'll just get a view of the sun also setting. It should pop out on the road now in front of us here. See them at all, Brian? Are we going? Should we stop or
a little bit further forward?
Just the other side of this Balanites tree. You got them there, Brian. Here they come, everyone. There they come. They're about to come onto the fire break now. I'm just giving an update there on the radio. Affirmative, due north. Let me just go a little bit forward, everyone. I think we might get them. They're on a game path. Game path, of course, very obvious sort of natural animal road that is particularly obvious at this time of the year. And I don't think they're hunting yet because they haven't fanned out. Here's the game path here that they are on. There we go. Look at them coming through the bush there. Isn't that lovely? And the male is now following. Herbie still with the male. Now they are fanning a little bit. There's one female behind. That's the lactating female. Isn't this wonderful? It's so lovely seeing lions move. And that's Amber Eyes there. Look at her orange eyes. Hello. Wonderful. All right, let me move. Stations, these three animals have now crossed the fire break, going due north. Let's try and get around a bit. Elephants have made such a mess here. They're at the Gallagher shortcut junction. Elephants! There they go. Friend Amber Eyes, that's her yawning at the back there. It's been a dreadfully tiring day. They're going straight into Biffle's Hook. That road in front there is Biffle's Hook boundary. I don't know if you have any idea how big they are, everybody, but they stand about 1.5 meters at the shoulder, so about 4 feet. They're quite tall. And they're certainly much bigger than any dog you've ever seen. About 120 kilograms for a really big lioness, like Amber Eyes. And 120 kilograms, about 240 pounds. So they're not small. Now the male is going to come up through these copper-coloured trees shortly. So we'll just stand by here for him. But there go the females. They also have now crossed into Biffle's Hook, about 50 metres to the west of the Biffle's Hook sign there. And look how beautifully hidden they are. What a perfect colour they are. And Roger, you are wondering about what they're eating, basically. You say, have there been any further kills since that big kill that we had on Biffle's Hook the other day? There was reports of three lionesses killing another buffalo on Biffle's Hook 2 days ago, and there's some confusion as to whether that was the Nkuhuma pride or the Talamati pride, which comes in from Kruger and from the north of Biffle's Hook, so I'm not sure who that was, but otherwise, no. And these guys look hungry. They didn't finish that buffalo. Okay. Herbie's just saying the mail is on its way. So we'll sit right here where we are. I'm just looking behind there while Brian tries to show you the last glimpses of the female. They lay down. Go yours. Not yet, no. Yes, we're still waiting for him. That's yours just asking if the male has come across. He will follow them. We just got to give him a little bit of time. He is, of course, quite a lazy fellow. Now, Zoomy Mike in Michigan, you ask a very good question about the coalitions, and you say, why is it that they have split up? Why would they not stay together? Surely the idea of a coalition, or the whole point of a coalition, is that you stay together and remain strong and you'd be able to dominate an area together. The coalition hasn't broken up. They spend less time with each other than other coalitions I've seen, but they're still in a coalition, they're still maintaining... Sort I heard him moving there. They're still maintaining the same territory that all four of them will maintain together. So it's not like the coalition's broken up at all. Maybe it could be safer and more effective if they stayed in twos. We won't know that until a challenge comes, until other males move into this area and try and sort of challenge them for the territory. But at the moment it's fine. They're marking the same areas, they kind of split the territory up between them, and you know, the coalition itself is still strong. Well, this male has not come. So let's go a little bit further forward. We might be lucky. Hello, Kurt. You're a new viewer, and it's wonderful to have you with us. Thank you for joining us, and thank you especially for asking us a question. You want to know why it is... Sorry, there's something stuck under the wheel here. Why it is that lions have got a black tip to the ears. They've got a black tip to the ears, Kurt, because it helps them to follow each other through this bush. Now, we watched them going through that quite thick bush, and you'll notice there are two colours that are absent from that area. One is white, the other is black. And so black is a really good colour if you want to have a following mechanism. It's the same reason that the black tail tip is black, so that they can follow that as they walk through the thick bush. I don't know where he is. I mean, Herbert pretty much followed him back up here. Right, and as Louise says, while we're waiting for this lazy male to arrive, let's head across to Jamie and get an update from her.
Oof. Well, we've definitely found the spot on Cheetah Plains where our Communications come through rather crackly, but that's okay. I believe we are live, we are live. And you have arrived at the perfect time, because this is where, or close to where, I saw the suspected, I mean, I'm willing to put my hands up and say I'm not 100% sure, but suspected brown hyena track. Unfortunately, no brown hyenas, but it's the perfect time of day for them. You never know. I think that is something that would make me truly very excited out on the end of our sunset safari. It would be absolutely marvelous. It's totally worth being out on cheetah plains very far from home at this time of evening, just to keep an eye out for them. You know, Jandre, not to put too fine a point on it, but Dave did spot a pangolin here. So, no pressure. Perhaps the brown hyena will be Jandre's crowning glory.
Perhaps James will invite us to his party.
That's true. Perhaps James shall invite us to the party, apparently, he was blithely singing away about. Didn't even know there was a party going on. I'm deeply insulted. They didn't invite the brown hyena either. Well, he hasn't got the memo. And there is no sign of our brown hyena. Apparently FC didn't get an invite either. It perhaps might be a party with just Brian and James, which admittedly would be thoroughly entertaining. Over to James, who's got the mail line.
We had the mail, unfortunately. He just popped out, and now he's going into Biffle's Hook. Going to quickly turn around so he can get a view, but that's going to be it. Anyway, it's so wonderful to see them standing up. They are magnificent creatures. And there he goes. He's sort of walking resentfully after the ladies. And if you want to see what a fresh lion track looks like, we'll show you shortly. Smelling where they've gone. We've had a couple of questions lately about whether or not animals are able to kind of follow each other's tracks on sight. I don't believe they can. I think it's largely done on smell, and I think that's what he's doing there, is smelling where they have walked. Gala. Terrile. Oh. Yeah, he's just hurting the lions. Herbie and I heard the lions growling. That's very, I don't know if you heard it, low throaty growl. Why he would have been growling. Of course, the males just crossed north, same place, 50 metres to the east of the sign, west of the sign, sorry. Anyway, that's going to be our lion sighting, everybody. Yeah, well, if you come straight to where you can see us now, you might get a brief visual. Hi, Herbie. Yeah, north and slightly east. So I'm just trying to help yours get in here. Now, just have a look there, everybody, on the ground. And I'm not going to get out of the car because there are lions there everywhere. That is the male lion track. In fact, I probably can get out. If I get attacked, Brian, will you tell everyone?
I'll show everyone.
Show everybody, yes. That's a good idea.
Careful, James.
I just want to show you the size. There's my hand. I'm not a very large fellow, but I'm not that small. And you can see that the lion's track is pretty much the same size as my hand. Slightly smaller, of course. There, maybe the top joints of my fingers missing, he'd have roughly the same size track. Not a big lion, not a small lion, but I'd say slightly smaller than average. So that's quite interesting, and that's his track there. I'm actually quite impressed that my hand's bigger than his. Ha ha ha. Okay, we'll head into the sunset here and then down the western fringes of Juma and see what we can see that way. Jelly, you say you're surprised that nothing alarm called at those lions as they walked through the bush. There were two birds alarm calling. There were some fork-tailed drongos there going and they were alarm calling at the lions, but none of the others, there weren't any other animals to be alarm calling at them. So there weren't any impala, there weren't any kudu or anything like that, and that's why they weren't alarming. If there had been an antelope or something like that, absolutely they would have alarm called at him and at the females. We'll just try and get you a view of the mountains here because we don't have a huge amount of signal in this area. And Ginny, in the UK, you say, do any of the predators have an alarm call? That's a really good question. Why do you look at the mountains? Well, I've got them too many sticks there. Let me go a little bit forward, everyone. No, I don't think predators do have an alarm call. Their alarm call is to growl, basically, is to say, stay away from me. That's what they do. I suppose wild dogs do have a little bit of an alarm call. They've got like a, oh, which is a sort of a bark to say, stay away. But I don't think any of the others have got an alarm call, no. It's an interesting one. It's more like a warning, a growl. There we are. Now you can see the mountains silhouetted by the last embers. Ah, very beautiful indeed. And that skyline, so indicative of this area, the Hoedspruit sort of a skyline, if you like. Many memories watching that skyline at this time of the day. I'm just listening. I can hear some impala alarm calling. Let's try and get a position for where they're calling. Yes, it sounds to me like they're on Sandy Patch, which is not too far from here. So I'm going to drive down there. Luisi, I don't think we're going to have signal as we turn onto that road, but we'll try. And in fact, let's go and get in there.
Oh, from a stunning sunset view to a journey on through cheetah plains. The temperature has dropped significantly, Gendre and myself. No, actually, Gendre, have you got a jacket on? Oh, you do, sort of. Piddly jacket. And Gendre is very stoic in the face of cold. I am not very stoic. Do you see that? Right in the middle there. In the middle of the spotlight.
On the grass? Or?
On the grass. What have we got here? Go right a little bit.
Right.
There you go.
Yep.
Serval! Hey, hey! How exciting is that? Absolutely awesome. Hey guys, how many of you have spotted the serval? Can you see it there? Ah, oh, yes! Actually, it's almost clearer if I take the spotlight down a bit. Have a look there. You can see it. The medium-sized spotted cats. Yay! This is so exciting. Absolutely awesome. It's so, so exciting. I love seeing serval. They are absolutely one of the coolest little cats and very, very rare. So what you're seeing, if you're a new first-time viewer, we only see once every couple of months. It's basically like a little mini cheetah with a very powerful spring. And this one is beautifully relaxed. Ah, oh, this is so marvelous. How awesome is that? I knew those ears didn't look like a dacre or a steenbok. Absolutely epic. This is the most relaxed serval in the world. And this is why night time in winter is just the best time to be out in the bush. You get all sorts of these sightings. In summer we would never have seen it. And she were probably sleeping there the whole day. And it's only because of the reflection of the eye that I was able to spot it. This might be one of the best serval sightings ever, just in terms of how relaxed it is. They are generally quite relaxed at night with the spotlight. Less so during the day. This is so cool. How's that, Chandra? Might not have been a cheetah, but we did find a serval. Hello, gorgeous. With your enormous ears. I'm really hoping, while we sit with it, that it's going to stand up and give you a view of its long, slender body. I said it's a medium-sized cat. What I mean by that is it is probably shoulder height, coming up to just above my knee. There we go. Oh, just getting more comfortable. This is so cool. Apparently James Richard was hoping for a serval sighting today, and we have provided one. Absolutely. I was hoping for a brown hyena, but I certainly am not going to turn my nose up at a serval. What I am going to do, if Chandra stays sort of... Hold on, it's moving. It's spotted something. It's going to pounce. Is it going to pounce? Oh no, it's eating something. I wonder if it's got... a kill. Oh, sorry. Try and keep my spotlight steady. It definitely appears to be eating something. I'm just going to reposition the spotlight ever so slightly so that it misses it entirely. That's not what I meant to do. I'm trying to change the angle. Definitely appears to be feeding on it, whatever it's caught. It could be a bird, it could be a small rodent. They are phenomenal jumpers. And incredibly good hunters. Oh, I cannot hold the spotlight up like this indefinitely. It's definitely not going to work. Let's try and find a way of repositioning it. Okay. That tree is just in the way. This is epic. A serval with a kill. This is definitely the way to go. And Aaron, yes, this does, I think, complete my cat collection apart from the caracal. So this isn't actually the first serval we've seen live. We had one on Zoe's Road. We've had a couple of them over time, but probably, as I said, once every couple of months. But Aaron... yes, this, apart from the caracal, I have seen every single cat it's possible to see out on drive, I think. I'm trying to think if I've missed one. No, the caracal is the only one I need to add to my collection. They're all members of the felid family, the caracal and the serval. Caracal is like a little bob, it's the South African equivalent of a bobcat. The serval is something entirely different. About twice or three times, twice the height. Maybe three times the weight of your average domestic house cat. That's why we call it a medium-sized cat. And since this one is relaxed, I'm going to brave repositioning. Trying to work out exactly where it is, Joe. If it hadn't been looking at us, I would never have seen it to start with. But I'm going to try, because I can actually hear it crunching. Okay, it's watching us, but it hasn't moved. It's still there. I'm just going to shuffle forward a little bit. I'm trying to think if forward or back is going to work. How's your view there, Genre? Or is it non-existence? Okay. So maybe where we were was the best. Sorry, say that again?
Maybe if we just stick our nose in slightly over there.
Okay. Let us try. Just make sure it's still there. Yeah, it is still there. This is so cool. Absolutely awesome. You can see it there. As subtle as a leopard. There is a road just in front of me. Oh, there we go. That's actually, this is fine. Let's not get greedy. And I'm scared of scaring it off, which would be utterly tragic. Although, I think with the kill, it is going to stay. Wonder what it's eating. It's actually quite large. I can hear the skin crunching. Diane, they eat a very varied diet from Franklin, lots of different bird species, eggs, amphibians, rodents, and scrub hares. I would not be at all surprised if this one hadn't caught a scrub hare. Okay, I've decided I'm gonna try and reposition. I'm gonna watch it. It's very relaxed, it's feeding. It does look up every time we turn the engine on. We're a lot closer than we were. I'm just gonna wait for it to relax. Hello. It's okay. It's okay. Promise that's as close as we're gonna get. This is awesome. I hope you guys are all getting screenshots. I'm going to give it another minute to see if it relaxes. If it doesn't stop looking at us, then we're going to back away. So we're just going to keep speaking. We're not trying to sneak up on you, buddy. It's all good. It's okay. Here we go. That's what we're looking for. A little bit of change in body language. Licking its lips, looking away from us. Okay, that's sort of what we're looking for. Signs that it is relaxing into our presence. This is so cool. This must be one of the longest serval sightings we've had. It's been a long time since I've seen a serval with a kill. Very long time, long before my time at Wild Earth. Absolutely epic. And Michael, absolutely, if Brent found serval tracks in this area, this could well be the serval that made them. So they do stick to their little areas. That's why we regularly see one along Zoe's Road. There's one that lives around the Mulwati drainage. Guys, as awesome as this is, unless this cat starts to feed... Ah, thank you. There we go. I was about to say, if it doesn't start to feed soon, I'm going to leave. Or pull away a little bit, just because it didn't want to affect its behavior, but it's eating now. So that's perfect. As awesome as these moments are, it's really important that we approach them with as much caution as we would show for any of the animals. And Michael, yes, it could well be the same serval. It's entirely possible. And just like our lions and our leopards, just on a smaller scale, they have their own home ranges and territories. I can't get over this. This is so cool. I wish we could see what it's feeding on, but I'm sure it's something like a scrub hair. Oh, it's heard something. That just goes to show, you never know what you can expect out here. This is so, so cool. We can even, I'm going to be quiet. I don't know if you'll be able to hear it, but we can try. You can hear it chewing. Could you hear that at all, Legendre?
Maybe just.
Oh, my spotlight's getting so hot it's burning my fingers. It's okay, it's totally worth it for this incredible sighting. Wow. This may actually be one of the longest I've ever spent with a truly wild serval. With a non-habituated serval. He or she probably had just made a kill when we drove up. Well done to everyone who is sending through their screenshots. This is absolutely magical. I will have a look at it when Brent returns back to camp this evening with my phone, which he has. But I'll definitely be looking at your screenshots later. Absolutely marvelous. This for us, and I don't want to compare things, but a sighting like this that is as rare as it is just the most incredible experience. We get so, so excited about it, more so than maybe I shouldn't compare. It's not a competition. You beautiful. I can't get over how close the servals let us get, and it stayed. Oh, I really hope this is a serval that we start to see regularly on cheetah plains. If it gets used to our presence. You can see I'm keeping my voice down. I'm not shouting, but I'm not whispering either. And I'm doing that very deliberately. I wanted to get used to the sound of our voice, but at the same time not feel threatened by it, and also not pretending that I'm trying to sneak up on it. Okay, we're gonna stay with our serval. However, it is James's last drive before he does go on leave. So I'm going to send you over to him so that he can say goodbye, and we'll be back with you shortly.
Bye! Say bye, Brian.
Goodbye!
That would be very rude of us. So we won't do that, everybody. We don't want to keep you away from that serval, even though our egos are stung by the fact that Jamie's found so much and, well, we've not found as much. Brian, thank you for all your efforts this work cycle. Thank you to Pinchy Weiner, the thumb for the day, and of course to the final controller and all the ladies, the technical crew, and mostly to all of you for all of your very kind comments and words and questions that spark so much joy and enthusiastic conversation. Thank you very much to all of you. There's some flying things around here. We'll see you in, 2 weeks' time. Until then, enjoy the serval and the rest of the safari. Bye-bye.
Back to our marvelous serval, who is still here and still feeding. And of course, we will all miss James tremendously, but wish him the absolute best on his holiday. And when he comes back, he can try and top the serval that we've had tonight. It was absolutely marvelous. What a truly spectacular way to end off our sunset safari. Jandre, you know you and I are only going to be back well after quite possibly after midnight at this point.
We're going to miss the party.
We are. We're going to miss the party, but it's definitely worth it. It is totally worth it.
Absolutely.
Moments like this are rare indeed. And yes, absolutely, Christina. So, our leopards and our cheetah, we always speak about them having a unique... Oh, and our spotted hyena, actually. Having a unique pattern of spots that is like a fingerprint to each individual. And Christina, absolutely, while I rest my spotlight holding arm, swap arms quickly, absolutely the serval do have unique spot patterns that would identify them. Each and every individual is different. So if we, look, it's going to be very difficult with the view we've got, but definitely get your screenshot fingers ready in case our serval does stand up. And then we'll be able to identify this particular individual if we ever come upon it again in the future. Oh, I'm so excited. This is definitely really cool. Absolutely marvelous. Valerie in Pennsylvania, I tried to get you to listen to the crunches of the serval chewing, but of course we haven't really got a good idea of its vocalizations. Valerie, very, very good question. Obviously it's not a roaring cat, it doesn't roar like a leopard or a lion, but it does, it chirps, kind of like what a cheetah does. It's capable of making sort of grrr. Well, that sounded a bit like a scops owl, that wasn't what I meant. A sort of a chirping sound. They hiss, they can scream or yodel, that's almost like the sound of your domestic house cat when they are having a confrontation or something similar. They do have a sort of the standard felid vocal range is, but they're not hugely vocal cats. It's only when they're mating or a mother communicating with her cubs, or perhaps they've encountered another serval in their area. It's only really in those situations that they start to vocalize. So they don't vocalize to mark territory in the same way that leopards or lions do. They're very, very different from the Panthera genus. And as Aaron pointed out, we definitely now need to add a caracal to our list. One last look, everybody, at our gorgeous serval as we come to the end of our sunset safari. And we do, of course, have the usual thank yous to make. A thank you to Jandre for his fantastic camera work as always, as well as to Lou and to the lovely Kirsty and Jerry in Final Control. I think Kirsty is having the afternoon off. Most of all, thank you to all of you. I don't want to distract you for too long. I want your sort of last images of this particular sunset safari. I hope you enjoyed it. It has been a marvelous evening. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye, everybody.